هيا على الفلاح.
She married a man known as Abdullah ibn Abd al-Asad. He was a nobleman. They accepted Islam very early. He took part in the Battle of Badr. He took part in the Battle of Uhud. He returned, but he returned injured. And he succumbed to his injuries at some stage. So she became a widow. Now, they got along so well that she said to herself, I won't be able to marry someone. Who can there be amongst the men better than Abu Salama? She had a few proposals and she said, no, I've got children. I'm now old. I can't marry. And I'm very possessive because I was literally spoiled by my husband in the sense that he used to pamper her. He used to, you know, look after her, take so good care of her. She was worried that I might never get that again. And then I'm going to start comparing and things will happen. And I might say something to my husband that will make him upset. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was from amongst those who proposed to marry her. She turned it down. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu was amongst those who wanted to marry her, proposed. She turned it down. Subhanallah. Imagine Umar, Abu Bakr, Siddiq radiallahu anhu. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam later in the fourth year of Hijrah proposed to marry her. And she said, you know, I have got three issues. One is I'm old. Two is I'm very possessive. And three is I've got children. So he says, as for your possessiveness, I make dua to Allah to help you overcome it. And you will. Number one. Number two, as for your age, remember, I'm slightly older than you. Subhanallah. And at number three, as for your children, they will be mine. I will take care of them. Subhanallah. So she says, okay, she accepted the proposal, got married. Instead of being known as Ummu Salama, which means the mother of Salama, she became known as Ummul Mu'mineen. She was known as Ummu Salama, but that was not her name. She had a child called Salama, so she was known as the mother of Salama, radiyallahu anha. Her name was Hind binti Abi Umayyah, and she was from the Bani Makhzum clan of Quraysh. She married a man known as Abdullah ibn Abd al-Asad. It is reported that they were amongst the top 10 to accept Islam. The two of them, they accepted Islam together. So when they had accepted Islam, Quraysh started harming them. They started harassing them, troubling them so much so that when the migration to Africa had started, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam allowed them to go. These were from amongst the first who left, the couple. They went and they arrived in Africa. They stayed there for a while and they lived very peacefully under An-Najashi as Muslims. But they missed Mecca. They really missed Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the other companions. They wanted to learn more. They wanted to be a part of the growth of Islam. When Hamza ibn Abd al-Muttalib and Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhuma accepted Islam, news went to Africa that now Islam has taken over in Mecca and everything is good. They've got power and strength. So these people said, well, then let's go back. So they started coming back and they came back. But it was not true that we were all now safe and secure. In fact, the harm started once again. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then permitted his companions to leave for Medina Munawwara for the Hijrah. And from amongst the first to leave, Abu Salama, Ummu Salama, and the child Salama, radiallahu anhum jami'an. So what did Abu Salama do? Wallahi, if you look at the history of this family, they were very loving. People used to give an example of the love of these. Loving in the sense that taking care of his wife. So Abu Salama says, let me prepare an animal for my wife. They got onto the camel and they started leaving Mecca, the first from amongst those who were leaving for Hijrah. But something sad happened, very sad. As they were leaving, some people from Bani Makhzum, the tribe of Ummu Salama, saw them leave. So they rushed to them and they stopped them because they were stopping people from going. They said, we don't want you to go. Now Abu Salama says, you have no right over me. They said, yes, but this daughter is a daughter of our clan. She's our daughter. We will never allow her to go with you. So Ummu Salama says, but I want to go with him. No, you won't be allowed. So they grabbed her, they snatched her, they took her, they pulled her, they dragged her. And Abu Salama was helpless because there was a group of people on one hand and he's the only man on the other. And they took her away. And just as they're taking her away, Bani Abd al-Asad, who is the clan of this man Abu Salama, they see the child Salama going with Bani Makhzum and the mother. They say, no, that child belongs to our clan because the father is from us. So they said, we're going to take him. And the people of Bani Makhzum did not argue with that. They said, okay, take the child. And here is Umm Salama crying for her child. Don't separate me from my child. As it is, you've separated me from my husband. Now you want to separate me from my son? It's the only thing I have, subhanAllah. No, they did not listen. Separated three ways. So the husband had no option. He went to Madinatul Munawwara. The wife was with the people of Bani Makhzum. And the child, Salama, a little baby, now gone with the people of Bani Abdul Asad. So subhanAllah, she says, I cried and cried, made dua, and I was lost. And I used to come out to the place where this whole thing happened every day. And I used to just cry and relive what was going on. She couldn't really eat properly, she couldn't think properly, she couldn't drink properly. And she says, I struggled and suffered. And days passed, months passed, and almost a year passed. And my condition deteriorated almost completely. Until one day, a man from amongst my cousins happened to see me, and he felt sorry for me. So he spoke to my family very strongly. And he said, look, why don't you let this miskina, you know, this poor woman, let her join her husband. What has she done to you? So he managed to speak to them and convince them to now let her go to her husband. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unite those who are separated from their husbands with them. Ameen. So she was really touched. But she said, I can't leave. What about my son? He's now almost a year old or a year old. So I can't leave without him. I'm going to go to my husband, but my child, a piece of me, is here. So after some time, someone else spoke to Bani Abdul Asad and managed to convince them to release the child. When they released the child, she was the happiest woman ever. Immediately she got that same camel of hers. She prepared it by feeding it well and getting a few things. And she jumped onto the camel and she was going. And subhanAllah, who was with her? Nobody. A journey that took almost 16 days. And you needed to know the way. And you would perhaps be waylaid by highwaymen. And so dangerous was the path. But she went all alone. She left Makkah al-Mukarrama. Who? Just the two of them. Her, her child and the animal. And they started going. She says, I made a dua to Allah. Oh Allah, protect me. I'm going for a cause. I'm making the hijrah. I'm going to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to my husband. And Ya Allah, you protect me. And as she got to Tan'im, the man responsible for the keeping of, or whose family was responsible for the keeping of the key of the Kaaba. This man, Uthman ibn Talha, radiallahu anhu, he saw her, he recognized her, and he remembered something. What did he remember? The father of Umm Salama was known as Zadur Rakib, the provisions of a rider. You know, when travelers used to come, if they came to Umm Salama's father's house, and his name was Abu Umayyah ibn al-Mughira, they did not used to bring any provision, because he used to provide for them. If you're going to him, you don't need anything, he will give it. So Uthman ibn Talha remembered this, and she said, oh daughter of Zadur Rakib, where are you going? She says, I'm going to Medina. He says, you cannot go alone, I will take you. Subhanallah. Now, the journey occurred. He really looked after her with utmost respect. You know what she says? She says, wallahi, wallahi. The way he got me off and on the camel, day and night for all the days and the food and everything else. So she says, wallahi, I've never been in the company of a strange man. But I know this man, a man that the way he honored me and how modest he was, is something that I would never see again. Subhanallah. Uthman ibn Talha, radiallahu anhu. We owe it to him because he looked after a woman who later became known as Mother of the Believers. So how did she become Mother of the Believers? Uthman ibn Talha arrived in Quba. He looked at the area and he told her, okay, your husband is in this area. I leave you and you can now enter safely. So she went in, she was united with her husband and her child, and she later had many other children, or a few other children. One was named Durra, one was Zainab, the daughters, and another son known as Umar. So subhanAllah, this man, they were so excited, so happy, and they lived a really happy life. He took part in the Battle of Badr, he took part in the Battle of Uhud, he returned, but he returned injured, and he succumbed to his injuries at some stage, so she became a widow. Now, they got along so well that she said to herself, I won't be able to marry someone. Who can there be amongst the men better than Abu Salama? But At the deathbed of Abu Salama, the Prophet ﷺ visited him and he made a dua. He was worried about his family. He was injured. And he was worried about his little children that he had and his widow that he was going to leave. So the Prophet ﷺ taught him a dua. Oh Allah, help me through my difficulty and replace it for me with something even better. So there was a dua similar to this that Muhammad ﷺ made him say. And he made a dua, don't worry, Allah will take care of what you leave behind in an even better way. And subhanallah, he then passed away, but she refused to get married. So until she became known as Ayyimul Arab, which means the widow of the Arabs. Now that was an insult, because at the time, the Arabians or the Arabs at the time, they would never leave a widow without getting married to her, someone getting married to her to look after her and her children. So this was Umm Salama radiallahu anha, Hind binti Abi Umayyah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam later in the fourth year of Hijrah proposed to marry her. So she says, okay, she accepted the proposal, got married, and she lived a beautiful life. Whenever they saw any one of her children, they knew this is a child, it has to be of Umm Salama. Because she was known, she was like a school. Her children were disciplined, well looked after. They were brought up by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Umm Salama. So during Hudaybiyah, she went with the mu'mineen. And amazingly, the Prophet ﷺ, they struck a deal with the kuffar of Quraysh and they were told, now we're going to go back. But they had come with their animals in order to make Umrah and they wanted to cut their animals at that time. But the Prophet ﷺ got up and told the people, his companions, that okay, since we have already made our intention for Umrah, each one of us, we have to sacrifice the animals we have and shave our hair and we're going back without the Umrah. And they were all saddened. No one moved. The Prophet ﷺ was looking at them. I've just issued an instruction and the companions have not yet moved. So he went into his little tent that he had and Umm Salama radiallahu anha was there. So Prophet ﷺ was looking worried. She heard what had happened. She is the one who suggested to him. Imagine, he's the Nabi of Allah. She said, O Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I have an idea. Why don't you come out and you get shave your hair and sacrifice your animal? So if you do it without saying one word, they will follow. Subhanallah, he said, that's exactly what I will do. The wife of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she gave an instruction, the whole army had followed. Subhanallah. So Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he came out, he did not say one word, sacrificed his animal, looked at them who was going to cut his hair, called him and said, you shave my head. And as that was happening, everyone started doing the same. So she looked and she was smiling and saying, didn't I tell you? Subhanallah. This was Umm Salama radiallahu anha. May Allah be pleased with her. She was a great woman. She had many students from amongst the Sahaba. She was the last from amongst the wives of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to pass away. She passed away when she was 90 years old in the year 61 Hijrah, 3 years after Aisha radiallahu anha. So she narrated a lot of hadith. Aisha radiallahu anha used to be known as one of the... She had a lot of knowledge. But Umm Salama, after the death of Aisha radiallahu anha, they used to come to her and ask her. And she had many students. They used to speak to the males also from behind the screen. It was something unique and amazing. And subhanallah, she lived in Medina Munawwara. She passed away. She's buried in Baqi'. Wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad.